The subject matter in Dark and Weird is for mature audiences only. Themes of violence, sexuality, and degeneracy are present in every episode of Dark and Weird. Listener discretion is advised, and listening is not recommended for people under 18 years of age. It is safe to assume that no episode of Dark and Weird is safe for work. There are many facets to the world of pop culture. From the treacle of pop music to the spectacle of the superhero film, there is another side to the pop culture that we immerse ourselves in. Just one channel over, or one more YouTube video deep, is a dark place, a weird place. Tonight we explore the dark and weird that is Deathmatch Wrestling. We all know about the world of professional wrestling. From Hulk Hogan and Sting to The Undertaker and Ric Flair, many of us grew up on the violent soap operas that were the WWF and WCW. But while the likes of Brutus Beefcake and Ted DiBiase were hitting the mats, something different was happening in Japan and Puerto Rico, something that would lead to what may be the most dangerous and controversial form of professional wrestling to date. My introduction starts far away and much later in deathmatch history, though. In the late 90s, I was introduced to the world of deathmatch wrestling through a friend of mine by the name of Rico Butchico. Obviously his Juggalo name, but that's a topic for a different episode. Rico and I were fond of spending our time at work talking about porn and breaking plates over our heads. One day, Rico passed me a video cassette, blank save the letters ECW scrawled on the label in permanent marker. From the first strains of the metal intro music to the faded, overdubbed, and scratched video of the tape, I was hooked. Scenes of pure chaos opened before my eyes. Piles of chairs being thrown into the ring on top of people. What looked to be barbed wire in place of ropes. Knives and screwdrivers being used as weapons. This was not your standard wrestling promotion, and it was like nothing I had ever seen. As I watched, I grew fascinated, and upon returning to work, I begged Rico for more information and more places to watch this kind of wrestling. He directed me to the wrestling section of the local video store, where I was able to procure videos of backyard wrestling and some early shoot fighting promotions. Think MMA before the UFC. Nothing compared to those first matches that I saw, so I took to something that was relatively new in our lives at the time, the internet. Digging deep, I found videos of the King of the Deathmatch 1995 from IWA, a combination of Japanese and American wrestlers in tournament-style event. Matches featured barbed wire, baseball bats, thumbtacks, and explosives, but I could only find these in bits and pieces of matches. It wasn't until years later that I was able to obtain videos of the entire event. This was my introduction, but the history of deathmatch wrestling is even less clear than that beat-up VHS copy of an ECW video. In 1998, a man named Atsushi Onita started a small, garbage promotion called Frontier Martial Arts Wrestling, originally intended to pit different types of martial artists against each other. Think the movie Bloodsport. In 1990, Onita had the first exploding barbed wire match with Tarzan Goto. This changed the face of wrestling forever. The concept wasn't new. In Puerto Rico's wrestling promotions, the idea of barbed wire replacing the ropes had been used before, but the addition of electricity and the spectacle of having the event in front of thousands in an arena brought a whole new element to the endeavor. Other Japanese promotions were quick to follow, and soon the idea was spreading via tape trading in the wrestling community all over the world. By 1993, promotions like Extreme Championship Wrestling in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, were carrying the torch of hardcore and deathmatch wrestling to a whole new audience, featuring wrestlers like Terry Funk and Cactus Jack that would end up in the finals of that IWA King of the Deathmatch I had found. Airing on late-night television, ECW was allowed to get away with more blood, more titillation, and more swearing than the two major promotions in the United States could handle. ECW was also showcasing more styles of wrestling than the big two promotions were, making it appealing to a fan base separate from the average wrestling fan. In an era where there were still some who were unaware of the scripted nature of wrestling, smart fans were looking for something a little more compelling than the fare that was being offered on WWF and WCW.
Here we go!
The type of product that ECW was developing created a rabid fan base. If a wrestler like Sabu or New Jack were willing to put their bodies at such great risk, the fans would remain endlessly devoted to the wrestlers. Like all good things, it couldn't last forever.
Get you anywhere! Talk about your Psalms, talk about John 3:16. Austin 3:16 says I just whipped your ass.
With the dawn of WWE's Attitude Era, wrestlers like Steve Austin, who developed a lot of his Stone Cold persona, his mic skills, and adopted the stunner in ECW, were turning up the violence and edginess for a wider audience. WCW stars were appearing on WWF and WCW programming, culminating in the ECW World Champion Mike Awesome appearing on an episode of WCW Monday Nitro. By 2001, ECW was filing for bankruptcy. Soon, WWF purchased the rights to the ECW, along with their video library, and using many of the gimmicks and tactics that ECW had helped pioneer, WWF and WCW began their infamous Monday Night Wars. That was not the death of deathmatch wrestling by a long shot. In 1998, a wrestler by the name of John Zandig opened a small wrestling school in New Jersey that soon developed into a promotion that in many ways would take the place of the ECW for fans of hardcore and deathmatch wrestling. Combat Zone Wrestling was born, and much like the ECW, began to feature all types of wrestling, with their main draw being the ultra-violence matches. By the early 2000s, CZW was working with Big Japan Pro Wrestling, a Japanese promotion that traded heavily in the field of death matches. Cross-promotion and talent trading happened, leading to many of the big names in America and Japanese deathmatch wrestling getting international exposure. Through continued work with Big Japan and other promotions like IWA Mid-South, their brand developed a base of fans that displayed the same kind of rabid passion that ECW fans had previously had.
Into the second row goes Leo Rush, and Callahan has this audience on their feet!
Mainstream wrestling had grown tired of hardcore and deathmatch wrestling. After absorbing WCW, WWE no longer felt that it had to compete on the same level. And in 2008, less than 10 years after the purchase of WCW, WWE announced that going forward, all of its programming would be PG and geared towards family and kids. In the underground fandom of wrestling, deathmatch wrestling was thriving. In Japan, promotions like Big Japan and Freedoms were carrying the torch, while stateside promotions like IWA, CZW, and Game Changer Wrestling have carried on the tradition. But that is all the past. Today, there is a whole new breed of wrestler that wants to be diverse and technical in all aspects of professional wrestling. Where the deathmatch was once just for spectacle, and often still is, wrestlers like Jon Moxley, formerly Dean Ambrose in WWE, have moved from small promotions into larger promotions and then back to a more independent climate for the sake of what they consider their art. In an interview with Ringside News, Moxley described it as, quote, "You don't have to go to the office and pitch this thing you want to do. You can pretty much do whatever you want. Everyone's just feeling totally free. I was describing it earlier. Dynamite's almost like one giant jam band session, because everybody's kind of collaborating together and working together, and everyone's throwing out different ideas for stuff that's not even their stuff. Especially once you get a bunch of different people in the same segment working together. The goal for everybody is making the fans standing and cheering at the end of the show. That's kind of the only thing they're worried about, and everybody's just kind of riffing and going along and being in the moment and being creative. Oh, you do this, and I'll do this. It's like a Fish concert, you know, except way better because I do not enjoy Fish concerts." Unquote. A part of that creative freedom was demonstrated in Moxley's match at Full Gear 2019 against Kenny Omega, where all the tropes of deathmatch wrestling were on display for a much wider audience than had been presented before. This is the kind of the match that in the past would have been relegated to the ghetto of late-night cable television, but in the hands of the fiercely independent AEW wrestling, it became the main event of a major pay-per-view, much to the chagrin of an old guard of wrestling commentators, and professional deathmatch wrestling isn't going anywhere. Featured in documentaries like The Hard Way and episode of Vice's The Wrestlers, and in the main event of what is arguably the second biggest wrestling promotion in the United States. The underground of deathmatch wrestling is still strong with promotions like GCW and Freedoms, focusing on deathmatches over everything else. More violence and more extreme spots have replaced the titillation of televised sex bombs in deference to giving males and females a shot at this extreme form of wrestling, in matches like ICW's Queen of Insanity Deathmatch. Understandably, there are critics of deathmatch wrestling. Many find it distasteful and unappealing, saying that it appeals to the worst side of humanity, that it is just spectacle of violence for the sake of violence, lacking the psychology and storyline that has become such an integral part of professional wrestling. Most notably in the world of wrestling media is Jim Cornette, in his own words.
Well, it's horseshit. It desensitizes the people to any type of legitimate worked violence. Can I say that? it desensitizes the people to seeing somebody get hit by a chair when they get hit by a chair 11 times and they get up. It's stupid. It serves no purpose. It's not entertaining except in a kind of a, you know, two dogs screwing on the side of the roadway. What do you come back with? How do you top it? Why would you cripple yourself at a young age or mutilate yourself for no compensation in front of very few people? Learn to entertain people, but learn to be an athlete, learn to wrestle, learn to be a manager at ringside, learn to do a promo, but don't wrap yourself up in barbed wire and beat yourself with broken glass. It's fucking foolish.
His disdain for the style of wrestling is an opinion held by many, but it isn't without its merits. Deathmatch and hardcore wrestling can go too far and are extremely dangerous, especially when something goes wrong. Take what is called the mass transit incident. In 1996, at an ECW house show, a man by the name of Eric Kulas, going by the name Mass Transit, presented himself backstage as a professional wrestler, unfortunately landing a match with one of the most unpredictable and violent wrestlers to ever have been in the ring, New Jack. During the match, New Jack used a razor to cut open Mass Transit in a technique that is called blading in professional wrestling. This technique is something that the wrestler usually performs on themselves, knowing their own pain tolerance and the depth of the cut they can handle. But in Mask Transit's case, being inexperienced, he allowed New Jack to perform the blading. New Jack cut far too deep, severing arteries and causing Mask Transit to pass out, landing him in the hospital. The fallout was drastic. All ECW pay-per-views were canceled, and Kulas' family sued the ECW. The combination of inexperience and unscripted violence made a bad situation escalate to its worst possible conclusion, save actual death. This drew criticism and coverage on a national scale, even making its way onto an episode of Inside Edition.
It's a 7 News exclusive, and we want to point out before we show the pictures, some of the video is violent and graphic. The boy claims he was brutally attacked in the ring. Tonight he says he thought he would die during the match.
Like many of these kids, Eric Kulis practiced wrestling moves he saw on TV and dreamed of making it to the big time.
What were your dreams? What did you think wrestling could lead to?
You know, making it to WWF, the WCW, you know. Being famous.
And with Eric flat on his back, severely bleeding, New Jack jumps off a top rope and smashes a chair in his head, knocking him out, and then gloats about the injuries he's just caused.
He claims that Jerome Young, whose wrestling name is New Jack, beat him and used some type of knife to slit his forehead, a cut requiring, he says, 50 stitches. Young is charged with assault and battery, and assault and battery with a dangerous weapon. Eric was asked, why didn't he get out of the ring?
Because I wasn't safe in the ring. Second of all, I wasn't safe out of the ring.
Why do you think that?
Because the fans were very aggressive. The time that I was there before, a fan got into an altercation with a wrestler, and I didn't want to go in the locker room because I didn't know what would happen.
321. All the attention, all the criticism, all the focus on the negatives of the nominally controlled carnage of deathmatch wrestling hasn't slowed it down one bit. In fact, with the dawn of the internet and the rise in availability of media from foreign markets, deathmatch wrestling from around the world is easier to find than ever. Add in the social media factor, and you have Facebook groups and subreddits that are devoted to the form. You no longer have to hunt down third-hand highlight reels, porno VHSs dubbed with episodes of ECW. Now you can have your daily dose of deathmatch wrestling from around the world in your YouTube or Facebook feed. Deathmatch wrestling isn't dying off anytime soon. The need to express frustration with the world, with life, is universal. The need to showcase how the everyman can overcome every obstacle, even if that obstacle is gusset plates to the forehead or a pile of light tubes on top of a piece of plywood covered in barbed wire. That need will always exist. Humanity loves watching itself taken to the limit. Humanity loves watching itself taken to the limit but surviving. For some, MMA is a good enough analog for humanity overcoming. Some of us prefer our stories told with a little more panache. We don't just want punching and kicking. We want some thumbtacks or barbed wire. Maybe even, on a special occasion, some explosives. What we want is deathmatch wrestling.